The incentive spirometer, an often used tool in clinical and often used incorrectly. If you've ever wondered how these things work and why we use them, stay tuned. We're going to go over that right after this. Welcome back. My name's Tammy, and this is Nurse Minder. And on this channel, we do everything nursing. So if you're new here, consider subscribing below so that you stay up to date with the latest information. Now let's get on to the incentive spirometer. At the end of this video, you should be able to answer the question about Mr. Jones's educational needs on his incentive spirometer. We'll come back to this. An incentive spirometer helps to ensure that the respiratory system is in the best possible position for maximal gas exchange. As we inhale, oxygen moves down into the alveoli, the functional unit of the lung. Taking a closer look, we see that there's a capillary bed that runs along the alveoli, and this brings blood supply, which is known as perfusion. Gas exchange occurs when oxygen can leave the alveoli into the bloodstream and carbon dioxide leaves the bloodstream into the alveoli to be expelled through exhalation. With a normal breath, we move 500 mL of air with every inhalation and exhalation. For a variety of reasons, though, our patients may not be able to achieve that level and are at increased risk for developing infection. Some of the typical patients that you can expect to see an incentive spirometer ordered for include surgical patients. Pre-op, we do a lot of teaching with them before they go, so they know how to use this when they come back. Post-operatively, it's needed for a variety of reasons. Sometimes it's the anesthetic that they had during surgery, and it's cleared through the lungs. So we want them to take some deep breaths so we can get rid of that residual anesthetic to lighten them up and to wake them up. If they've had surgery in that thoracic or abdominal region, they might be breathing shallow just because they have some pain, which we can use medications. They may have some fear or anxiety about if they take too deep of a breath, are they going to rip open those sutures? So we definitely want to get them using the incentive spirometer, and we can teach them some splinting techniques, which I'll show you a little bit later. Another population are those who have reduced mobility, and that can be for a variety of reasons. Bariatric patients, patients who have had fractures, we've got the geriatric patient population who maybe need their aids and they can't get out of bed without our assistance. And then we have other patients who are just too sick to get up. So we want to make sure their lungs are still functioning at optimal capacity. Another population could include our burn patients. If they've had anything around the head or neck for injury, there's a risk of swelling and a risk of compromising the airway. Inhalation injuries as well are a particular concern for us, so we're going to use the incentive spirometer for them as well. And the last one would be those who have any sort of conditions that might impact immunity, so hematological disorders and where they're at risk for lung infection. And then of course we have all of our respiratory and cardiac pathology that might impact ventilation and perfusion. There's a lot of patients who might be using this. It is just as important to know when not to use an incentive spirometer or when to question the order for an incentive spirometer. For example, our patients who have had a head injury, we would be worried about adding to the increase in intracranial pressure, and that would be a good discussion point with your healthcare team. Another population includes patients who have had surgeries to the eyes or plastic surgery. Those are areas where we may have sensitive surgeries that would not benefit from the additional pressure the incentive spirometer would create. In addition to clinical pathology that might be a risk factor, we need to also consider the age of our patient. Pediatric patients who are quite young don't have the fine motor skills, nor can they follow the instructions to use the incentive spirometer appropriately. And so we might try an alternative strategy like a deep breath and hold. In the geriatric population, and even in our regular population, there may be cognitive deficits that are preventing them from understanding the instructions and implementing it. In addition, there can be pathology that causes difficulties with those fine motor skills, and that they have a hard time struggling with the physicality of the incentive spirometer. Let's look at the two different types. The first is a volume oriented, which means I can dial up the desired volume I want them to inhale using the yellow marker. As they inhale, the yellow plunger will rise with each breath, and ideally if they hit that target, there will be a yellow ball in this happy face. The advantage to the volume-oriented incentive spirometer is that the patient can measure their progress with each breath. Now, the second type that we'll be demonstrating today in this video is a flow-oriented incentive spirometer. This style has a number of movable balls that are pushed up by the force of inhalation and suspend in air while that patient inhales. We're going to demonstrate that one in this video. Before we go through how to use the incentive spirometer, we need to get our patient in the best position. And sitting up is the best position to be. It is ideal to have their back free from the mattress for that full lung expansion. But if they can't get up, you can also use the reverse Trendelenburg. When it comes to assembling the incentive spirometer, it often comes in two pieces. And one would be the mouthpiece that we're going to attach here. And then we're ready to go. So in instructing your patient, you want them to make sure that they've just exhaled normally. And then they're going to seal their lips around the mouthpiece and inhale slowly and consistently so that they're raising the balls if we're using that flow meter at a consistent rate. Now up close, I'm not sure if you can see that, but it says 600, 900, and 1200 cc's per second. So if I can keep the white ball up for 3 seconds, that means I have inhaled 1800 mils of air, which is well above my tidal volume, and I'm definitely getting great recruitment in those lungs. Now let's look at how to use it. First, you want to exhale normally, put your lips around the mouthpiece and seal, and inhale consistently and slowly. Inhale, inhale, and when you get to the top of that breath, hold for 3 seconds, and then exhale. Take a few recovery breaths, and then start the cycle again. Now, if you can't use the incentive spirometer, we can use deep breathing and coughing, so let's talk about those splinting strategies. The first is to have your patient interlock their fingers, open their palms, and press it against their surgical incision. Apply pressure, take a deep breath, and cough. The second strategy involves taking a pillow, applying pressure directly over your wound, and taking a deep breath and cough. Now, let's go back to that NCLEX question. If you're not ready for the answer, pause now, because here it comes. If Mr. Jones were to say, I need to tilt the incentive spirometer to reduce effort, or he's going to breathe in as fast as he can, you need to do more teaching. If you got those right, congratulations. Well, that's our lesson for today. I hope you enjoyed it. Give a thumbs up if it was helpful. Comment below and let me know what you think. And if you have some ideas for future videos, put them there as well. Be sure to subscribe. You'll be the first to know when the next video comes out. I've got some other videos populating here that you might be interested in, so enjoy, and until next time, make it a great day.